Rods. I represent this appeal arises from the district court's orders to deny Starline the right to amend its counterclaim and also dismissing Starline's claims that were alleged in its first amended counterclaim. Unfortunately, the case fell into the procedural moot grinder of having an arbitration facet as well as a non-arbitration facet. Starline and EHM / DMV, which was one of the subsidiaries of Warner Brothers, the other defendant, had a contract, and they brought suit in the district court against Starline. And when Starline counterclaimed, EHM moved to compel arbitration, which then resulted in a little bit of a different posture here than you might see in a formal lawsuit. The court had ordered the arbitration of Starline EHM to go to JAM to take place and save the remainder of the case. But before the state was imposed, Warner Brothers had filed a motion to dismiss the counterclaim. So all of that got stayed in May of 2016, and the case had barely gotten out of the gate. After a two-year stay, the case came back in the end of May of 2018, and the arbitration was on its own track, and Warner Brothers and Starline were back in court. There was a single claim against EHM that was still before the district court for a declaratory relief. After the scheduling conference, the court set a trial date, set final status conference, and set the case on its usual way. In the interim, Starline wanted to amend and met and conferred with Warner Brothers counsel about amending. There was no agreement, and after that meeting, the conference was exhausted. Starline filed its motion to move to amend to file a second amended counterclaim. The court took up the matter in October of 2018 and decided that Starline was not entitled to amend and granted in whole a Warner Brothers motion to dismiss, which then sort of gives rise to some of the facts that are more colorful for the purposes of this appeal. The final status conference was scheduled to take place in February, and Starline filed a statement with the trial court, district court, indicating that the case seemed to need a dismissal because plaintiff Warner Brothers was not pursuing the claim, and Starline had one claim against EHM that was decided effectively in the arbitration proceeding. And by then, on the track of the arbitration, Judge O'Fierro, our district judge, had also decided that that case was not related to what was before him. In the statement that was filed with the court, the memorandum of intent to the fact and law.
Counsel, are you attributing the request for dismissal to the trial judge?
No, Your Honor. I'm attributing the matter was brought to the court's attention.
And I think the record ends there. At that point, correct?
Not exactly, Your Honor. I think what happened is the parties filed a stipulation that he cites that the court has suggested in order to not appear unnecessarily for a case that was not going to go anywhere if people were going to dismiss, to file a request for dismissal, which the parties filed a stipulation to that effect, essentially at the suggestion of the district court. And I would imagine that the district court suggested it, that would not be something the court would object to. But I think that the proof positive of that fact is there was a final status conference set and the trial date set shortly after. And we can write a little bit of a distinction to the business. If you have a final status conference or a trial and as counsel you don't show up, the district court is going to let you know that you did exactly the bad thing. So in this case, I think the court took those matters off calendar, and it's an indication, and then there was a filing in the docket that reflected the matter was closed by way of that stipulation. So I think to the extent that we're talking about the district court being involved, we don't have a signature from the judge, as I guess in retrospect you would love to have, but what we have is I think the judge's shadow over there. No one went behind the judge, no one tried to hide or file a unilateral or anything. I think both parties submitted basically on the suggestion that we should not go on with a lawsuit that has nothing left in it, both from plaintiff, Warner Brothers side, on the Starline as a counter claimant. So it's our position that the submission of the dismissal and the court's taking off the hearings off calendar and ending the matter essentially ended everything that was before the district court at that time for that purpose. The crux of our appeal before you is that the standards for granting. I guess we've learned that. I'm not sure if it's a brief. Sorry about that. We kind of put all the details of what was going on, but we think the court did not apply the correct standard. And essentially, when you just show what the district court did, the court believed that there was undue delay. And that's the sole reason. And I think case law and going all the way up to the Supreme Court is pretty clear that delay alone is not a justification for denying, nor do we think objectively, given the facts of this case, there was any substantial delay. Starline filed its motion to amend shortly after the stay was lifted. The trial date hadn't come, the discovery cutoff hadn't come, the motion cutoff hadn't come. There were a whole host of factors that indicate there was not undue delay, and there wasn't anything, so to speak, preventing the moving of goods.
Can I interrupt you? I just really need for me, what exactly are the actions of the district court that you believe rise to the level of meaningful participation in the settlement of this case?
The district court suggested the dismissal by stipulation so the parties avoid appearing. So by converse, if that suggestion
where is that in the record? Was that in a status conference transcript?
Your Honor, it is not, because that was to avoid the status conference. The stipulation to dismiss that appears at excerpt for the record, page 041 to 042, actually specifically on the second page of it, on line 4, says, and at the suggestion of the court to avoid an unnecessary appearance at the pretrial conference scheduled for Tuesday, February 19, 2019, stipulated to voluntarily dismiss the remaining portion of the action. We think that the court's direct pen was not involved, the court's shadow.
Wait, so there's that. Okay, there's that action, the suggestion. Is there anything else that you contend constitutes meaningful participation?
If you look at the excerpts of record, page 040, there's a report that's on the filing or determination of an action regarding patent or trademark, and in the that form, that's a court form, has a decision judgment section, and it expressly states 2/13/19 joint stipulation to dismiss case pursuant to FRCP. So we think those things would not have happened in a unilateral dismissal case. We think the court taking the hearings that were on calendar for the subsequent weeks off calendar, there's no indication of the court's displeasure with not having those matters come up on its calendar, we think shows the court was substantially involved in directing the dismissal of this case and was aware. The court's authority. Unless there's a specific question, I think we've answered everything else there. I don't want to belabor the point. If there's a question about something, I would try to answer it. Otherwise, I'll reserve my rebuttal.
All right. Thank you, counsel. Mr. Espenshade?
Good morning, Your Honors. Andrew Espenshade of Dury Tongri LLP. For appellees, EHM Productions, Inc. and Warner Brothers Entertainment, Inc. May it please the court. The recent case of Galazza v. Wolf has set forth the rule that decides jurisdiction in this case. It says, quote, "We therefore hold that when a party that has suffered an adverse partial judgment, as occurred here, subsequently dismisses any remaining claims without prejudice, as occurred here, without the approval and meaningful participation of the district court, as here, this court lacks jurisdiction under 28 U.S.C. 1291. That's at 954 F3rd 1272. That holding followed the holding of American States Insurance Company and James B. Price Stern Sloan. Under straightforward application of Galazza, the court lacks jurisdiction over the appeal. Argue that Galazza recognized that the court may treat a dismissal without prejudice as one with prejudice where such an intent is evident in their supplemental letter brief at 2. But that is not the holding of Galazza. Galazza stated again, where there is a voluntary dismissal without prejudice, quote, the district court's involvement was needed to establish whether that dismissal would produce a final appealable order or judgment. Again, that's at 954 F3rd 1272. The approach that Starline advocates is that of Judge Paez's concurrence in Galazza, or something close to Judge Paez's concurrence. But Judge Paez's opinion was at odds with the majority, as even he recognized, in wanting to do away with the requirement that the district court be meaningfully involved and participate in the dismissal. That the district court meaningfully participate in dismissal without prejudice serves an important purpose. It's not merely a procedural mechanism. The record on appeal is unlikely to allow a panel to determine the party's intent and whether manipulation might be present. The district court, by contrast, is in a far better position to make these determinations. Evading that critical step puts the onus on the appellate court to try to often minimal evidence in the record. Such an effort would not only be speculative, but if accepted, the well-established rule that dismissals without prejudice do not create appealable judgments would cease to exist. I'll now move to whether the district court meaningfully participated in the dismissal here, as Judge Wardlaw had specifically asked about. The actions by opposing counsel do not approach the level of meaningful participation. The first conduct that was mentioned was that the court had suggested that there be a dismissal. Such a suggestion first came before there was any dismissal. Secondly, says nothing about whether the dismissal would be with or without prejudice. The court was merely a final status conference coming up, and the parties should decide what they were doing with the case. Secondly, the report to the Patent and Trademark Office was, as it on its face, in the record at ER 40, issued by the clerk, not by the court. There's no indication that the district court gave had any participation in that document. And in fact, it was issued the day after the stipulation was submitted, indicating that it is done pro forma upon the stipulation of the parties, and it notes on its face that the stipulation called for a dismissal under Rule 41A1A, which does not require court a court order. So neither of those acts constitute meaningful participation. In this case, as in Galazza, the district court was not asked to and did not enter an order approving the stipulation. As in Galazza, the district court was not asked to and did not enter judgment following the stipulation.
Well, was the case closed?
The case in front of the district court was upon the dismissal by the parties. There were no more claims pending, and as a matter of procedure at that point, the clerk did close the case.
Well, it seems to me, and having been a district court judge and telling my more current experience with this, but it does seem to me that having dismissed the granting Warner's motion to dismiss the first amended counterclaims with prejudice and denying Starline's move to amend, that's pretty much with prejudice. I mean, not denying it, yeah, with prejudice. That's pretty much end this case, right?
It ends the active pursuit of the claims before the district court, but of course, the claim for declaratory relief, which was dismissed without prejudice, could have been refiled by Starline at any point. And in fact, that declaratory relief claim related to actions between Starline and TMZ that were at the heart of the arbitration, which Starline is separately pursuing through a separate appeal now before the Ninth Circuit.
Right, but that's what the stipulation dismissed, right?
It dismissed without prejudice, such that if, again, we have to speculate here, Your Honor, but if you're asking what the potential harm is, Starline was not prepared to go forward with a trial at that point. They dismissed without prejudice and could come back and refile that declaratory relief claim at any point, and we would have a pending appeal, but also a pending claim in a district court seeking relief under the previously dismissed claim.
Counsel, what part of Rule 41 are you saying that's under?
Your Honor, Rule 41A1A, Part 2. Is
stipulation of dismissal signed by all parties.
Yes, and that is defined as a voluntary dismissal without a court order. There is a separate part of the Rule 41A2, which requires the court order. Had the parties submitted a stipulation requiring court order, the court would have had the opportunity and would have been required to look at the stipulation, consider it, sign it if appropriate, and we might be in a different position than we are now, where there is no meaningful participation by the court. And as the Ninth Circuit stated in American States Insurance Company v. Dustar, which is cited in Galassa, any action by the district court upon a stipulation that did not require the court's approval is not meaningful consideration. The stipulation submitted in which Starline dismissed its case did not require and did not have any district court participation. I would briefly go on to on the same issue. Even if district court participation were not required under Galazza, which it is, or even if somehow the acts cited by Starline were deemed to be meaningful participation, there would still have to be a showing that the intent of the parties was to dismiss with prejudice rather than without. And there is nothing in the record that indicates that the intent here was to dismiss with prejudice. The stipulation itself says multiple times, it cites the rule that was just referenced, 41A1A2, which does not require a court order and is without prejudice. It says in multiple places that it is without prejudice. There is no reference in the stipulation to an appeal, to the fact that it was for the purpose of filing an appeal. It was for the purpose of avoiding the final status conference. And the orders that are at issue in this appeal were from October of 2018. The stipulation at issue came 4 months later. If the purpose was to correct the record such that the appeal could be taken of the October 2018 orders. That stipulation and the dismissal of Starline's remaining claim should have taken place immediately or soon after the court's rulings on the two pending motions in October of 2018. The logical inference is that Starline intended to do what it did, which is dismiss the claim without prejudice. And under Galassa, American Insurance, American States Insurance, James, and the other line of cases, a dismissal without prejudice does not allow jurisdiction for an appeal. And finally, just on this note, the last thing is, to the extent that Starline believes or states that this lack of jurisdiction of a fully briefed appeal constitutes some kind of inefficiency or waste of the court and the party's time, this issue was brought to their attention very soon after the appeal was filed, back in over a year ago, August of 2018. We noted that there was no jurisdiction for this appeal. Rather than attempt to correct the record or perfect the record such that there would be appellate jurisdiction, Starline continued and went forward with the appeal as is. I would like, unless there are questions on that issue, I would like to move briefly to the decision by the district court to deny the motion for leave to file a second amended counterclaim, which Starline's counsel stated was the crux of the merits of this appeal. It's undisputed that this issue is decided under an abuse of discretion standard. It's also undisputed that the district court issued a 10-page order in which it considered each of the factors set out in Foman v. Davis and reaffirmed in Ninth Circuit authority. The order is at ER 14 to 24. The district court analyzed undue delay, bad faith, previous amendments, prejudice to the opposing party, and futility, each of the factors that it is supposed to analyze on such a motion. Therefore, it considered the right law, and unless there was a manifest misapplication of the facts, the district court's opinion should be respected and affirmed. The court noted that four of the five factors it weighed were against permitting amendment, and the fifth was neutral because it could not say unequivocally that Starline acted in bad faith, which is hardly a ringing endorsement, but it considered that factor to be neutral and relied in, to a great extent, on prejudice and undue delay. I want to quickly note the timing, because that was gone into by counsel, just to make sure it's clear.
My question, because I don't think 6 weeks from the end of the arbitration is necessarily undue delay.
I would like to address that, Your Honor, and I'm glad you asked. Starline states that it obtained the necessary information that for its proposed amended counterclaims in the party's arbitration, which took place in February of 2017. It ended on February 21st, 2017. That statement by Starline is at SER 245. Between February of 2017 and the May 2018 status conference, the parties submitted five joint reports to Judge Otero, informing him of the status of what was going on. There was no mention in any of those five reports of any intent by Starline to amend its cross claims. Those are in the record at ER 193 to 195 on the docket of the district court. And at the May 2018 status conference, when the parties have been away from the district court for a long time, Starline has had 15 months at this point since the arbitration to consider and prepare its amended counterclaims that it says it should bring. Not only does it not mention the fact that it intends to amend, but when the court asks counsel for Starline about setting a trial, counsel for Starline said, no problem setting it for trial, Your Honor. That's at ER 27. And I encourage Your Honors to review again the transcript from that status conference, because the court goes on to set dates, trial dates, discovery cutoff dates, summary judgment motion dates, all of which were based on Starline's statement that the case should be set for trial without a word about an amendment. Amendment only came up when EHM out all of the claims that were already arbitrated. And even at that point, Starline did not say it intended to add anything. It said it would do that, and it took another, until late July, another 6 weeks before it provided a proposed counterclaim that was very different from what it said. And added parties, it added claims, and it added new allegations and facts. And I'll just say, as my time is ending, we are unaware of a single case in which a district court's denial of leave to amend, supported by factual findings of prejudice and undue delay, as was done here, was reversed by this court. This is in the discretion of the district court. If you look at the order and what the delay and prejudice were, it was fully justified and should not be disturbed by the panel. Unless your honors have any questions, my time has run out.
Thank you.
Well, it's interesting. That mentioned the entire action would be dismissed and recited the court's suggestion for such dismissal and does not want to live by those words anymore. The fact of the matter is, Warner Brothers wasn't doing anything with the case at all. Starline filed in the record, and I already referenced it for your honors, the and law, and advised the district court that Warner Brothers had essentially abandoned, they were the plaintiffs, they were the ones to sue. They had abandoned the complaint. And more pointedly, for the one claim that was left against TMZ, and if I could digress here, as just earlier you mentioned, as to Warner Brothers, the court had dispositively dismissed all of the claims against Warner Brothers on the motion to dismiss. So there's nothing pending as to Warner Brothers. Starline advised the district court, Starline specifically told the district court this statement. This court dismissed all Starline's claims against Warner Brothers and ordered all Starline's claims against TMZ to arbitration, except for its declaratory relief claim. Therefore, all that remains of Starline's counterclaim is the claim for declaratory relief, because the issues raised in that claim have been addressed in the arbitration, which is currently pending on Dan's appeal, and because this court has stated that those arbitration claims are not related to this case, Starline requests the court dismiss its sole remaining claim for declaratory relief against TMZ. So the whole point that there was anything pending before the court at the time is just not true. And in fact, factor on the Galazza case, as was pointed out by dissent and concurring majority, that there was a claim pending. And nobody's making earth-shattering law about any of this at this point. Galazza was running on a different section of the FRCP where you do a unilateral dismissal under part one. This is a stipulated dismissal by the party who's complaining now about having dismissed, treating it as if it was unilateral. The fact matter is the district, if the intent of American States case that's been cited is, as was mentioned in Galazza, that the active involvement of the district court would have empowered the district court to manage the development of this action, thereby facilitating efficiency and avoiding this future appeal, that is what Judge O'Hara did. Told us to dismiss by suggestion, we did it, filed a final status conference, that's the management we're talking about, and try to go uphill on that one by them doesn't make any sense. There's a practicality rule. It's not a gift. It's not gratuity. There's a reason why we have the practicality rule in the Ninth Circuit. If a dismissal is effectively the end of the case, it's sufficient to trigger the awards. As far as the undue delay factor for the motion to amend, obviously there's not a good answer. So Warner Brothers wants to now break the seal on the state period to say that Starline ought to be penalized for the period of time that the case was stayed in order to not have that too. They wanted it stopped, and now they wanted it to count against Starline. We think that's unfair. And the trial court application of the not correct, and it was non-prejudicially to deny Starline its right to have claims decided on merit. And unless you have a specific question, I see I'm ticking away into the ether, and I appreciate the opportunity to make this presentation. And good to see you, Justice Clifton, again.
Thank you very much, counsel. Okay, EHM Productions versus Starline First of Hollywood will be submitted, and we'll take up My Choice Software versus Travelers.